Hey folks, Dr. Rossinell here. It looks like we're looking at foreign policy during the long 50s. So that's going to be Eisenhower and Kennedy. Okay, let's see what we got. Jabu. Ooh, the new look and the new frontier. The new look, that's what Eisenhower called his program. And the new frontier was with Kennedy. One of the obvious new frontier programs was the moonshot, right? Getting to the moon. And new look, we're going to have things like the interstate system, the highways. Okay, but we're talking about foreign policy. So Eisenhower wins in the 1952 election, and he's got some issues to deal with. Yeah, boom. First, we'll start with, Korea? I'll just mention Korea here. The Korean conflict comes to an end shortly after Eisenhower takes the oath of office for a number of reasons. One, Stalin dies. Okay, the dictator of Russia dies, and there really wasn't a lot of support for Russian support of the North Koreans. So that comes to an end. Eisenhower promises to bring the war to the end. So the sides come together and they just basically call ceasefire. There's an armistice. There's a truce in place. So and we keep troops there, and the troops are there today. Remember, folks, once we send in troops, we rarely remove them. Rarely. Like really rarely. Iran. Iran had been technically a neutral country during World War II. The United States will use Iran to shuttle supplies to Russia to try to, ensure the Russians don't quit on us like they did in World War I. But Iran was led different times in the 20th century by various different types of governments. Well, the Shah, that's the Persian name for Caesar. The Shah of Iran was a dictator, and the people of Iran, after World War II came to an end, didn't want this guy, and so they called for elections. And they had democratic elections, and they had a constitution, and they had a legislative body, and they had this guy, Mohammad Mossadegh. He was the prime minister. Well, Mohammad Mossadegh said, among other things, that the natural resources of Iran should be for the Iranian people, not for them foreigners. Well, the foreigners, particularly here, were the British. See, Great Britain signed a contract with the Iranian government in like 1906, somewhere around then. And so the Iranian oil went to the people of Great Britain. Well, so he says no more, and he cuts them off. He nationalizes the Iranian oil industry. Well, that ticks off Britain, but Britain can't do anything. They don't have any. They're pretty much devastated because of the war. So they turn to the United States. And Eisenhower turns to a new organization called the Central Intelligence Agency, the CIA. And so the CIA instigates a coup. We get rid of the democratically elected government of Iran. And we put the Shah, this evil, brutal dictator, back in place. And man, he's going to massacre Iranians just by the sackful. Just slaughter them. Until 1979, when the people rise up, he will lose authority over the military, and that's always a good lesson. If you're going to be an evil, brutal dictator, once you lose control of the military, it's time to leave, because there's nobody there to protect you. So the United States will support this dictator to the extent of creating the fourth largest army in the world. That's Iran. Okay, Iran. We got the United States, we got the Russians, we got the Chinese, not necessarily in that order. We got those three, and then the fourth largest is Iran. Okay. We also put a lot of intelligence listening posts in parts of Iran, so we can collect all sorts of cool stuff about what the Russians are doing. So we get rid of this democratically elected leader. Well, the same thing's going to happen in Guatemala. Okay, people of Guatemala hold free and fair elections, and they elect this guy, Jacobo Arbenz, to be their president. Well, Arbenz says, kind of like Mossadegh, who is a nationalist. Okay, Mossadegh was a nationalist. Arbenz is a nationalist, and Arbenz says that the resources of Guatemala should be used for the Guatemalan people, not for them foreigners. Well, the foreigners he's talking about is the United Fruit Company, okay? The United Fruit Company owned more of Guatemala than the Guatemalan people did. And, man, they made a lot of money. So, let's see if this thing's gonna load.
I'm Chiquita Banana, and I've come to say bananas have to ripen in a certain way. And when they're flecked with brown and have a golden hue, bananas taste the best and are the best for you. You can put them in a salad. No, not yet, my dear. That greenish way you're looking means that you are ripe for cooking.
How about me?
No, no. When you are fully ripe, my dear, those little flecks of brown appear.
Me?
You're most digestible, my friend. Delicious, too, from end to end. You can put them in a pie. Any way you want to eat them. It's impossible to beat them. But bananas like the climate of the very, very tropical equator. So you should never put bananas in the refrigerator. Bananas are a solid food that doctors now include in baby's diet. And since they are so good for baby, I think we all should try it. Oh! See, 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 see.
So, he nationalizes the land owned by the United Fruit Company, but he says, we're going to pay him back. Okay, we're not just going to take it, we're going to pay him back. That's not good enough for the United Fruit Company owners or the U.S. government. So we got John Foster Dulles and Henry Cabot Lodge, two guys that are super duper high in the U.S. government. Okay, Secretary of State John Foster Dulles and Henry Cabot Lodge, I believe, was the Undersecretary for Latin American Affairs or something like that. They also own stock in United Fruit Company. And they are going to launch a coup to get rid of the democratically elected leader of Guatemala. And in his place is going to be a military dictatorship who is going to terrorize the people for, almost 50 years. Yep. So that's two democratically elected leaders that the United States got rid of because we were fearful that they were not pro-U.S. enough. Okay. This is a world in which it is split down the middle. There is no gray area, okay? You are either for us or against us. You either wear the white hat of Western civilization or the black hat, maybe the red hat, of the godless Russians. Mm. And so there was some concern that nationalism, like what happened in Iran and Guatemala, you know, suggestions that the leaders of Guatemala and Iran were going to turn towards the Russians. Well, now we turn to Vietnam. The United States had been involved in Vietnam since October of 1945, when the U.S. Navy started to ferry French troops back to militarily retake Vietnam. But in 1954, the French lost a major battle called Dien Bien Phu up near the Chinese border, and the French pulled out. Now Eisenhower was furious. Okay, he wanted and was going to give the French anything they needed, short of U.S. troops, to stay in the war. And the French said, "No, we're done." So the United States is going to kind of hand select a leader. A president of South Vietnam, this guy, his name is Diem. The problem is Dan likes to speak French. He really loves a lot of Western stuff. He's Catholic in a country that's not Catholic. And so he wasn't the right choice. Well, some of his military officers will come to that conclusion during the presidency of John F. Kennedy, and they will assassinate Diem, supposedly with the help, or at least the okay of the United States. So, in 1954, the United States begins to support South Vietnam by bringing in supplies. Now we got Egypt 2 years later. Another nationalist comes to power. This guy's name is Anwar al- wait, no, not Sadat. I forget his name. Oh, Nasser, Gamal Nasser. There we go. So there's a military coup. The military, there's like seven or eight guys who's leading this coup, and they get rid of their king and send him away, and with a lot of money. And then Nasser is the one who of those seven or eight military officers who really rise to the top. I mean, he's tall, he's handsome, he's well-spoken, very charismatic. But he's a nationalist. But he goes beyond that. He says, we are going to be neutral. Okay? We're not going to choose a side. Because if we choose a side, we lose trade with half the world. We are going to buy the best weapons. We're going to get the best deals on food. We're going to get the best deals on trade. And if that comes from the United States, great. If that comes from Russia, great. If that comes from a American ally or a Russian ally, that's perfectly fine because we're neutral. We will not get involved in the Cold War. We don't like neutrality. You're either with us or against us, and he was not with us. Well, what he wanted to do was build a series of dams to irrigate parts of Egypt for agricultural purposes. And he, at the same time, two things happened. One, he goes to the World Bank and asks for a loan. And two, he sells some cotton to Czechoslovakia in exchange for some weapons. Now, a lot of countries were doing that. Okay, Israel did that, but the United States didn't scream bloody murder. But they do it, the Egyptians do it, and the United States uses that as the pretext of stopping the loan through the World Bank. So once the U.S. withdraws its support for the money that Nasser needs to build this massive irrigation system, Nasser then nationalizes the Suez Canal Company. Not the Suez Canal, the Suez Canal Company. The Suez Canal was built, French started it, the English finished it. But there was a contract. There was an agreement between Great Britain and Egypt that said the Egyptians can run the canal zone. Okay, they're going to pilot the ships. They're going to open up the locks and raise and lower and all that stuff. But the money that the ships have to hand over to go through the Suez Canal, okay, from Europe here to the Middle East, as opposed to going all the way around Africa, okay, that money's going to go to England. And Nasser says, nope, not anymore. We're going to keep the money. Okay, so England, once again, can't do too much on itself. But there was a little caveat to that agreement between the Egyptians and the Brits. And the caveat said, if the Suez Canal is ever threatened by an invading power, then England had the authority to invade Egypt to protect the Suez Canal. Because the Suez Canal was super duper important. So here's what the Brits do. The Brits goes to the Israelis and they say, we'll pay you to invade Egypt. Then when you do, we're going to say, oh my God, look at that. There's a foreign power and they're going to take the Suez Canal. So we, the Brits, we're going to invade to protect the Suez Canal and take it back from the Egyptians. There's a picture of some Egyptian or some British troops paratrooping it. Yeah. Well, the United States goes to the United Nations and demands the Israelis and the British immediately withdraw from Egypt. And the reason they did that is not because necessarily in love with the Egyptians, because they're neutral, which means they're not with us. It's because at the same time, Hungary, okay, tries to gain their independence from Russia, and Russia invades and just crushes their independence. So the United States cannot go to the United Nations and say, hey, you evil Russians, get out of Hungary, and not say, hey, you Israelis and the Brits, get out of Egypt. So there we go. Under Eisenhower administration, we have the Voice of America. The Voice of America was the United States is going to hire native speakers to give news, propaganda, submitted to various countries about how great we are and how horrible you are. Voice of America still runs today. We're still pumping this stuff into Cuba, and the Cubans try to block it. We have the United States Information Agency, in which the federal government would get newspapers from around the world and translate them in English, or collect radio broadcasts from around the world and translate them in English. All sorts of great stuff for historians to go through. But these programs came to an end for the most part as a result of who's that? Always wondering, people are slowing down from my house because of 9/11. To use money on the war in Afghanistan. So we moved to Kennedy. Well, two big things, Cuba and Vietnam. Now, Cuba had been a little island nation, 90 miles away from Key West, that had been controlled by a dictator. And the dictator lost control of the military, and so he takes his family and a lot of money, and they flee. And who takes over are these communists, okay, definitely communists this time. Okay? They were not communist in Iran. They were not communist in Guatemala. They are definitely communist in Cuba. So the Eisenhower administration tries to formulate a plan on how to get rid of Fidel Castro and the evil, godless Cuban communists. Well, the plan is ready when Kennedy becomes president. So Kennedy wins the election of 1960. He gets sworn in January. In April, the CIA says, boom, here's a plan. Here's what they're going to do. They're going to take a whole bunch of these Cuban exiles, these the sons of the relatively wealthy who fled Cuba. They're going to take them to Guatemala and train them, okay, to be soldiers. And then they're going to take these guys and send them into Cuba as an invading force. At the same time, the Voice of America is going to start pumping information in that the Cuban people are just in mass rising up against Fidel Castro and the godless communists running the island. And the U.S.-supported Cuban exiles who were trained in Guatemala land at an area called the Bay of Pigs in April of 61, and the Cuban people do not rise up, and everybody is captured or killed. So that was kind of an oops. So you would say, why didn't the people rise up? Why did they want to live under a godless communist system? Here's why. Because what Castro did is he took that land that all those wealthy folks owned and he redistributed it. He did things like universal health care and universal education and job programs. He gave these people things they did not have, which was hope for a better future. You're going to rise up against that to go back to a U.S.-supported dictator? Not smart. Not a smart move. Bay of Pigs, huge failure. Not a lot of time, however, to be complaining, because Fidel Castro turns to the Russians and say, we got to make sure that the United States isn't going to do something stupid like invade us in force. So how about you bring us some missiles? And so Russia starts building this massive system that would eventually be able to launch nuclear missiles from Cuba, just 90 miles from the United States. They'd be able to hit just about any place in the United States except for the super-duper far Pacific Northwest. Washington, D.C. in just a few minutes. Okay, it wouldn't take long to decimate the country's government. So what are we going to do? Excuse me. The missile sites are built. The runways are built. What they don't have are the actual warheads. Well, we got some photographs. Here they come. We know they're coming. We see them. They're on that ship and other ships like that. And so Kennedy goes on TV and he's telling people, hey, man, here they come. Okay, so get ready for it. We got to stop them. Now, the idea was, what about a blockade? What about if we take the U.S. Navy and just, you know, line them up here and say, we're going to blockade Cuba. We're not going to allow you to cross our blockade line. And the reason they don't do that is because blockade is an act of war. So you don't want to do an act of war. You don't want to have a, you don't want to start a war with the Russians. And so it's Bobby Kennedy, President Kennedy's brother, who was the attorney general. He says, it's not a blockade. Let's call it a quarantine. And I'm sure somebody in the room said, what the hell's a quarantine? He said, well, it's a blockade, but we'll just call it a quarantine. Okay, so it's the same thing. That's what they're doing. It's quarantine. They're just gonna, you know, make sure that those ships with nuclear weapons don't get past the blockade. I mean, the quarantine. But it worked. It worked, and all the ships turned around and went back. So here's an editorial cartoon. Look at this. Decisive foreign policy. Yes, 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 yes. There's the Russians weeping, running away, dropping their missiles. See, the black hat. Dun, dun, dun. Ooh. In the cowboy movies, the cowboy indie movies, the good guy always wore the white hat. The bad guy wore the black hat. So there's a black hat Russians. Ooh. Well, this isn't exactly what happened. What really happened was that the Russians did not want U.S. nuclear missiles that close to their border in Turkey. So Kennedy says, we'll remove our missiles. You don't put your missiles in. And that's how they came to that agreement. That's called settlement as opposed to brinkmanship. Vietnam is turning into a god-awful mess. Remember, I said that the guy in charge, DM, is a pro-Western in his dress and his appearance. He loves to speak French. He loves French culture. He's Catholic. In fact, he even goes so far as to prohibit Buddhists from engaging in public activities. And so this is not going to end well. And we have things like this. We have protesters, a Buddhist monk who just sets himself on fire, kills himself. There's going to be one American who does this outside of the gates of the White House. Yeah. And so here's a famous photograph of President Kennedy in November of 63 talking to his brother Bobby. Now, clearly something serious is going on. Okay. Look at his shoulders are down. Right? His arms are crossed, but they're higher than his. He's saying something real serious. Now, we weren't sure what was said until it was released by the federal government, declassified, and man, when was that? I want to say like 2005, 2006, somewhere around then. Because there's microphones all over the place here in the White House. They just stepped outside of the Oval Office and they're speaking. And here's what Kennedy says. We're getting out of Vietnam. It is a quagmire. We're going to pull out. So why doesn't he? 1963, folks. He's running for re-election. 64 is the election year. So it's November 21st, 1963, and President Kennedy is here in Houston, Texas. He goes to the east side, okay? He meets with a lot of these Viva Kennedy groups. Okay? His wife is a fluent Spanish speaker. Okay? They did a hell of a job of getting out the Hispanic, the Mexican-American, the Spanish-speaking vote. Viva Kennedy clubs, they were called. And so first he goes there, and then he goes to... And then he goes to this really ritzy black tie affair at, I believe it was the Rice Hotel. So two very different groups of people he meets. The next day he goes to Dallas. Two shots to the back of the head. And the guy who takes over, he believes we can win Vietnam. Chuck Berry. Deep down in Louisiana, close to New Orleans, way back up in the woods among the evergreens, there stood a log cabin made of earth and wood, where lived a country boy named Johnny B. Good, who never ever learned to read or write so well, but he could play a guitar just like a ring in a bell. Go, go. This is supposed to be autobiographical, okay? He plays this role that he was a super poor kid who just had this natural talent and just wow. But of course, not the case. He grew up in a very middle class, racially mixed suburb in St. Louis. But it was a great background story. So one of the creators, whoa. I guess that's it. We're done.